Being a data scientist, you might not write object-oriented code every day like a developer would do. You may never have to write object-oriented code in your whole career. However, without knowing it, you are interacting daily with object-oriented programming through your use of packages and frameworks. Common data science libraries such as Pandas, NumPy, and scikit-learn all rely heavily on object-oriented programming. In this video, I'll explain some of the core object-oriented programming concepts in simple terms from a data science perspective. First of all, what is object-oriented programming, OOP? It is a programming paradigm that organizes programs as objects, data structures consisting of data fields and methods together with their interactions. It is just one of the programming paradigms implemented in the popular programming languages nowadays. Other programming paradigms include procedural programming and functional programming. Together with OOP, each of them is good in certain use cases. Alright, so why do we need OOP? We cannot understand nor appreciate OOP if we don't know what kind of problem it solves. Most of us dread spaghetti code because it's too confusing to read and maintain. Take a look at this code structure. I hope it looks familiar to you. We can see here 5 different functions calling each other and a bunch of global variables that are accessed and used by one or multiple functions. Just imagine this structure expands a few times. Things will start getting very messy and difficult to follow. Imagine that we could somehow transform this messy spaghetti into lasagna with different layers and neatly organized. Isn't it much better? I personally like it better too. OOP solves this exact problem through 2 principles, encapsulation and abstraction. 2 other main principles are inheritance and polymorphism, which I'll also talk about in a second. Encapsulation means that OOP groups variables and functions into entities called objects. Variables inside objects are called properties or attributes, and the functions are called methods. Think of properties as characteristics of an object, such as a cat has blue eyes. On the other hand, methods are essentially the ability of the object to do things, such as a cat knows how to catch mice and say meow. Objects can interact with each other by making reference to each other's properties and by calling each other's methods. Encapsulation makes the code easier to reproduce and maintain. If we want to replicate an object to 10 different objects, we simply replicate the whole object instead of replicating the individual's variables and functions within the object. In Python, classes serve as the code template to create objects. This is similar to constructor functions in JavaScript, if you know JavaScript. But note that functions within a class cannot access directly the attributes of the class. Instead, we need to use the self keyword to access the attributes of the class. This is also similar to the this keyword in JavaScript. In the methods within classes in Python, the self keyword is always put in as the first argument. To create an object from the class, an object is created using the constructor of the class. In Python classes, you often see the init method, and this method is simply used to initialize several attributes of an instance of a class. Another very useful concept and functionality of OOP is abstraction. When we don't want other objects to access and modify properties of an object, we hide these properties from other objects or the outside world. This is called abstraction. Our mobile phones are examples of abstraction. The interface offers us only the relevant handles to use them, but the things like chips and memory cards are hidden from us. In Python, you can hide a class attribute or an instance attribute by adding the double underscore prefix to a variable. This would give a strong suggestion not to touch the variable from the outside of the class. If we now try to access the company attribute of this person, Python would throw an attribute error saying person object has no attribute company. Well, this is pretty neat, right? The next principle is inheritance. Inheritance is a mechanism in which one class acquires the property of another class. For example, a child inherits the traits of his or her parents. With inheritance, we can reuse the attributes and methods of an existing class to create a new object, and therefore inheritance can make your code more reusable. The last principle of OOP is polymorphism. Poly means many, and morphosis means to form or to shape. It basically refers to the ability of a function to perform in different ways. A simple example of a polymorphic function in Python is the length function. This function can be used for a string, counting the number of characters in a string, or it can also be used for a list. In this case, it will count the number of elements in the list instead. This is an example of a function that does different things depending on the type of argument that is passed to it. As you might have realized, there are many, many benefits of using OOP, such as making your code more reusable, more scalable, and more structured. However, there are also downsides of using OOP too. In the worst case, the real world just refuses to divide up into neat classes and objects, and sometimes several objects will interact with each other in complex and unexpected ways. In addition, OOP can require more code and more complicated for smaller projects or projects in which there are very few repeated tasks. In data science, a lot of times we are just experimenting and exploring data. In those cases, it's also not very useful to write object-oriented code. Not to mention that if you're not careful, your object-oriented code can be also spaghetti-like as well. For instance, if you allow a class to change the properties and behaviors of another class, which leads to unexpected behaviors of the classes. From my experience, data scientists in general are not very keen on using object-oriented programming in data science projects for reasons like it's more code, it's more difficult to read and debug. I've had a data science project where we had some heated debate on whether we want to use object-oriented programming or not, and one colleague of mine just did it anyway in object-oriented style, and she's a brilliant programmer, but other data scientists just hated it. So if you want to incorporate OOP into your project, it's good to have a discussion about it to avoid conflicts like this. And in general, OOP is great for production setting in a data science project, but if you are still at the exploratory phases, it might not be the best choice. I hope this video gives you a better idea of what OOP is and help you now easily understand Python packages and frameworks and how to use them more effectively as a data scientist. Thank you for watching and hope to see you in the next video. Bye bye!